Now, for tonight, I've been asked to talk about alcohol, alcohol related to liver transplantation. And I want all of you to take a new look at how we look at evaluating and managing patients with alcohol related liver disease. So, first, relax, don't take notes. So just sit open and open up your mind and let some new ideas come into your head tonight. So specifically, we're talking about the evaluation and management of patients that are going for liver transplants. There's a lot that we could talk about with regard to alcohol-related liver disease, but when we're talking about transplant, there are some unique aspects of it. Now, the most important thing is that no matter how you cut it, no matter what you believe, what you think you believe, there is a stigma associated with not only alcoholism, but how we look at patients with alcohol-related liver disease. Now, for those of you that have been following this over the past several years, there's been a change in the terminology of what we call these different various conditions. And the changes are as follow. So now we call it alcohol-associated liver disease, alcohol-associated steatohepatitis, alcohol-associated cirrhosis. But the one thing that has not changed, alcoholic hepatitis has not changed. And the authors that have talked about a change in terminology, they said, well, you know, alcoholic hepatitis is such a classic disease that we don't want to change the name. We're still going to call it alcoholic hepatitis instead of alcohol-related, alcohol-induced hepatitis. So I think they're being a little less than forthright in wanting to remove that line alcoholic and try to reduce the stigma. So take a look at that and beware. Now, when we get to evaluate patients for transplant, it seems as if there's everybody else, those with viral hepatitis, autoimmune disease, fatty liver, and then there is the alcoholic. We do look at these patients a little bit more differently, a little bit more critically. Now, what I wanted to do is share a few recent phone calls, inquiries into my office from physicians that were wanting to refer patients for transplant. And it is mind-boggling the calls that I've received lately. For instance, an 82-year-old man with cirrhosis and an ejection fraction of 10. Clearly, for many reasons, this person is not a transplant candidate, but they really wanted to make sure that they were not missing any opportunity for this patient. Okay. Next one, 30-year-old female, cirrhosis due to non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, a recent gunshot injury to the chest, who also developed likely hypoxic brain injury. They're calling just to make sure, are they a transplant candidate? Of course, they're not. Next patient is a 67-year-old man, cirrhosis, COPD, oxygen dependent, with a recent diagnosis of esophageal cancer, wondering again, are they a transplant candidate? And lastly, 70-year-old man, recent open heart surgery, went for a triple bypass. Unfortunately, within a week or so, one of the grafts failed, went into acute heart failure, suffered an MI, may have had a brainstem stroke, and they are calling, because he developed ascites, can we think about a liver transplant? So again, many of these calls are really inappropriate candidates, but the point is, patients that are appropriate candidates, possibly a 40-year-old with alcohol-related liver disease, is not being referred because they're an alcoholic, hence the stigma. And as you're all familiar, there is this thing called the six-month rule, and that was developed in the very early days of transplant. And the basic tenet was you needed to be free of alcohol for at least 6 months and participating in some sort of relapse prevention program. Now, I get calls all the time, or we see patients, and when we have a conversation with them, they said, no, I have to be free of alcohol 12 months. So now somebody somewhere has invented the 12-month rule. Where is that rooted in research or clinical trial or general accepted practice? People are just freelancing and making up the rules as they go. So the bottom line here is there is a double standard. We don't like to admit it. We all have our own little bias, but there is a double standard when you're looking at the patient with alcohol-related liver disease and transplant compared to other disorders that we see. Now, think about this. Alcohol is the third leading cause of preventable deaths. Number one and number two is smoking and inactivity and a bad diet. Basically, obesity and eating the wrong foods. But I think those individuals get a bit of a free pass. Now, imagine if somebody walked in to a lung clinic with a Joe Camel t-shirt on. Would the doctors in any way say, wait a second, this is no good, we're going to delay treatment or not offer him treatment? How about if somebody walked in with a McDonald's t-shirt? Or if better yet, in the waiting room or in your office, they're there for non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, metabolic syndrome, and they're sitting eating Whataburger. Would anybody be alarmed at that? Is it any different than having an alcoholic beverage while they're waiting for you? I don't know. Whataburger hurts your liver, alcohol hurts your liver. Who's getting a pass here? I know you're probably not thinking about this tonight, but I do want you to realize that being a little absurd here drives home a point. Now, what about if somebody with true alcohol-related liver disease is in Dr. Gobriel's office saying she's here for a liver transplant sporting a very chic Budweiser t-shirt? How would that go over? Probably not too well. And lastly, getting back to this whole six-month rule, let's imagine it's your father or your brother or your wife, goes to the cardiologist, having chest pain, they do an angiogram, they say, look, good news, you've got a stentable lesion in your coronary artery, but I'm not going to do it for 6 months until you stop smoking or you lose 25 pounds. Does that make any sense? Double standard. That's what exactly we're saying for the patient with alcohol-related problems. Stop drinking, shape up, and then come back. Now, if you look back at the literature, in the early 90s, there were some very interesting articles talking about how we should address, those of us in transplant, how we should address the alcoholic. And this is what they said, and I quote, "There is the presumption of relapse to heavy drinking, which might damage the new liver or lead to its rejection. A second line, presumption that alcoholics brought their condition upon themselves and should not compete with non-alcoholics for scarce donor livers." They're telling you, these patients should not be allowed to be transplanted. Now, going on with the stigma, other things that have been written in the literature talking about how should we approach the alcoholic and the stigma associated with alcoholism. Well, if you look at how the people in the UK look at it, over 50% of the population there feels that the alcoholic is personally to blame for their liver disease. In the United States, they talk about bad character, the way they were raised compared to other mental conditions. The way you were raised, that's the decision on whether or not you get a liver transplant. So what you're seeing is this negative social perception along with feelings of stigma. And it just is a circular ring here of bad emotions. So with all of this negative social perception, it's estimated that 95% of all those with alcohol-related liver disease are not being referred for liver transplant. And so, again, when I get phone calls for referrals, I get a phone call from colleagues, all not that far away from where we're sitting right now, that they say, we don't do those kind of cases. We don't do alcoholics. You can if you want. I'm just giving you his or her name. So they're telling you, we're not going to do it. But why? What's your stigma? What is your hang-up to give this person a chance? And so what happens is the healthcare professionals, be it nurses, doctors, pharmacists, social workers, mid-level providers, we are having our emotions hijacked by the very thought of dealing with a patient with alcohol use disorder. And my sense is, and I've been looking at this for a good number of years now, it comes down to emotional intelligence or lack of or a deficiency of emotional intelligence. We have trouble with our social skills dealing with these troubled patients. We lose a sense of our empathy for these patients and what they've gone through. We lose our self-awareness as to how we're being perceived, and we have to learn better how to manage all of these emotions. Now, another great quote out of a recent medical article states the following: "Moreover, it has never been considered ethical for clinicians to refuse treatment to patients for diseases that are partly or wholly preventable." We should not be doing that, blaming them for their medical condition. And that's what we're seeing with the alcoholic. Now, one of the first things we did at least 10 years ago when we started to revamp our alcohol program for transplant was we called in our medical ethicist, and we wanted their opinion. How should we look at this from an ethical standpoint? And one of the most key things, the most important things that they said was, as long as there is no difference in survival, there is no ethical problem. It's all about the survival. So when you look at the stats from 2019, the NIAAA database, we have experienced about 95,000 deaths related to alcohol. Now, the stress alcohol consumption related to COVID has been a real problem for a lot of people. In adults over 21, they are reporting that there is a 60% increase in alcohol intake and a greater number of days that they're drinking. So this is really getting out of control. So as you can imagine, all of this added drinking is just infusing an influx of patients into the system that need to be evaluated and treated. Whether it's transplant or not, these people need care. Now, the COVID lockdown has not been good for this either. And when you look at some of the politics of this, before the COVID lockdown, no state permitted bars or restaurants to deliver liquor to customers at home. Now, 28 states are allowed to do this. In a similar fashion, the legalization of the sale of to-go cocktails increased the number of cases that could be sent directly to the consumer. So the bar, no pun intended, the bar to getting alcohol delivered at home has gone way down, increasing the use of alcohol. And it is now estimated that alcohol contributes to about 50% of the cases of cirrhosis that we're seeing, and it's probably going to increase over time. Now, all of this is evident by looking at the data on the number and the distribution of adults waiting for liver transplant. You could see that the number of patients for alcohol-related liver disease has gone high and is probably the leading reason to be on the transplant list. Likewise, the number of patients for hepatitis C, as we have all these great new drugs, has gone down at the same time. And as you could imagine, as there are more people on the list for alcohol-related liver disease, the number of transplants is going to go up and is going up as well. Ditto, the number is going down for those with hepatitis C. The main point here is when you look at graft survival and patient survival, it's very, very good. And again, these numbers don't lie. Looking at the graph here, the lines are showing that those with alcohol-related liver disease have the best, if not close to the best, survival following transplant up to 5 years. Now, a lot of people would think that the alcoholic goes back to drinking, they don't take care of themselves, they are irresponsible, they're just going to go back to the old behavior again. They're going to have a survival curve that looks something like this. Well, clearly, this just is not true. They do very well. And so I think when you look at all of the data here, that survival is as good as any other disease that we're willing to transplant, both the community, the public at large, and our colleagues are throwing all this science, all the data, just right out the window. They're not paying attention to it. They don't want to believe it, or they have some deep-seated bias or stigma associated with this. The other part that we have to always talk about is that we get lots of patients to be evaluated for transplant that have a history of alcohol in their past. But we have systems in place to evaluate and diagnose in a multi-specialty fashion to decide the patients that we will list for transplant and those that we will reject for transplant. I believe we've all worked very hard over the years refining this process, looking at our data, and that also needs to be expressed to the community and to our colleagues. It is not an open door policy that we will transplant anybody. We have a system in place to evaluate and manage and stratify and decide who goes on the list and who is rejected. So recent data shows that about 1 in 200 adults between the age of 40 and 65 years old have cirrhosis. That's about 60 million people. And if you do the math, that is about 300,000 cases of cirrhosis in the United States. And for my Aggie friends, that is about 300 packed Kyle Stadiums at Texas A&M. That is a lot of people that we need to treat. And so, in summary, what do we need to do here? Well, in a sense, knowing is not enough. We have to take action. And the four takeaway points for tonight. Number one, we need to advocate for our patients, regardless of the cause of their liver disease. It doesn't matter. Advocate, advocate, advocate. Number two, the data wins the argument every single time. Survival, survival, survival. No ethical dilemma there. Number three, all of us need to be on guard for our own double standard. Again, we don't like to admit it, that how could I have a double standard? How could you have a double standard? We're above the fray. I'm sorry, we all tend to have moments where we experience a double standard, but we have to catch ourselves and our colleagues. And number four, the most important, we have to educate our colleagues, we have to educate the civilians, the non-medical people, our neighbors at church, those we work with, those in our community, about this data, about how we have to advocate for the patient. Until we do that, we're going to continue to run into misunderstanding and not being able to do what the right thing is for our patients. Hopefully you enjoyed this and it shed a little bit of light and made you think just a little bit more and to be a little bit more cautious how we conduct ourselves,